Welcome. Good morning. The first education, business education event of the year, put on by the LaGrange Business Association and the Education Committee. I'm Kathy Dirks, Chairman of the Education Committee. And how about a few, I've got a few thank yous and things, some housekeeping things. This seminar is presented by the College of DuPage, and this is kind of the culmination of some work we've been doing as a collaboration with COD, and we're excited that they're here today to help enlighten us on some issues and ideas on how to become a better leader. This seminar is one of our first sponsored seminars, which is very exciting, and this seminar is sponsored by Sally Noss, SAN Coaching. Business leadership and coaching is Sally's bailiwick, and this fits perfectly with her. We want to thank LTTV for providing the video. This will be on YouTube, and I know there were some members that were not able to attend today, so they can watch it, and you can encourage people to watch it, because the second of this series will be April 17th, and this will be a follow-up to this one. I'm thinking that there's maybe a little bit of homework and ideas that you might want to participate with, and you can also share that with your friends and encourage their participation in the April seminar. Thanks to Nancy, as always, and Lori for putting this, making sure all the operational things happen. And I think that's probably, yes, and allowing this to happen is our esteemed president, Mr. Joe Kroc from First National Bank of LaGrange. Please give our esteemed president. You take esteemed is wonderful. Our presenter today is Hilary Burkinshaw from the College of DuPage, and one of the small business division at College of DuPage. If you haven't had the opportunity to find out what they have and what they can do for you as a business person, you're shortchanging yourself. This is an amazing facility with so many free resources. Just absolutely excited about what COD can do for you, some charged, some free, a lot more free than not. And it's a wonderful way for you to grow your business and grow your own personal leadership skills. And I'm going to let Hilary and Amanda do their own introductions, because they know much better than I do what they do. Both in terms of leadership and presentation skills, we're very excited and pleased. Thank you very much for being here. And last thing I'm going to say is that what I hope that you get out of this seminar, I was listening to a podcast. Sally got me on podcasts a couple of years ago, and there was one that was Jim Collins, the leadership coach, was interviewing Peter Drucker, another business legend, and they were trying to figure out, in terms of starting a new business, what was important? What was the litmus test for being successful? Is the question asked, are you successful? Is the question asked, will you make a lot of money? And Peter Drucker's comment was, no, those aren't the questions to ask. You ask the questions, are you useful? And if you think about that, is what you're doing useful to you, to someone else? And everything else will follow down, it'll trickle down if it's useful. So hopefully we've provided something useful for you today that you can use and take away a few tips and tricks, and I'll be back in April with some of your results. So thank you. Hilary?
I'm actually going to go first.
Oh, great.
Thank you. My name is Amanda Scorosi. I work in the continuing education department at the College of DuPage in a division called Business Solutions. So Business Solutions, a lot of people aren't aware, does events sort of like what we're doing today. We offer classes at our main campus in Glen Allen in all different business areas leading to certification, like project management, Lean Six Sigma, Scrum Master, all kinds of classes for the working professional. We also do a lot of training at businesses. So any type of training that you feel like your business may need, we could do at your company. We could come to your company or have your company come to campus. So if you haven't been to the college lately, you should definitely stop by. And it's growing so much and really a great place. So with that, I will pass it off to Hilary.
So okay. While Hilary's doing that,
There is a form that,
good.
Because this is a partnership, I know you all registered for this event, but if you wouldn't mind just filling this quick form out, this is just for the college to know who is here today. So if you wouldn't mind filling these out at some point while you're here, and then just, you can just leave them up here once you're done, before you leave today. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And there will be a survey by COD at the end, and that would be yes. very helpful if you can fill those out.
Thank you.
Yeah.
It would be really helpful if you don't mention the technical difficulties.
Not only having technical difficulties, there's going to be a couple of issues because I'm not terribly used to being tied to the back of a podium or to a microphone. And now I know that we're being videoed, my next job is to nip down to Weight Watchers and join, I think, is probably the next job. I'm going to actually take my last slide and talk to you about it first. I'm from the Center for Entrepreneurship at the College of DuPage. Kathy mentioned it. What we are is we are part of College of DuPage. We are partly funded by College of DuPage, and other fundings come from the U.S. Small Business Administration and the Illinois Department of Commerce and Economic Opportunity. And with that funds, with those funds and the College of DuPage money, we've set up three centers. One is the Small Business Development Center, the other is a Procurement Technical Assistance Center, and the third is an International Trade Center. Those services are designed to work with small businesses from the day you think, it'd be really nice to start a business, through to the day you think, time for me to get out of this business, and all points in between. We offer one-on-one counseling, free counseling, and I am just a very small part of that team. There are three of us that work in the Small Business Development Center. The Illinois Procurement Technical Assistance Center, which for brevity we call PTAC, is the center that helps people with government contracting. All manner of government contracting, you can access, again, a free service through Procurement Technical Assistance Center. They will help you with obtaining certification as women-owned, minority-owned, veteran-owned, all of those certifications. And it's not quite as simple as you would think it is. Part of the equation is knowing exactly where to apply and which agency to apply to get the best coverage for your business. And every day, they provide all of their registered clients with a bid match list. So that's a set of every bid that is being offered by the government, federal, state, and local, that is out there, comes into your desktop. And the third center is the International Trade Center, helps small businesses in Illinois get into exporting. And that's not only products or services, it is services as well, that can be exported. And you've got Canada just up the road there. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of opportunities if you understand how to get into that gig and how to work through it, and that's where they will take you through the whole process. Marketing, there is assistance to help you go to trade shows, attend trade shows all over the world, and so on and so forth. So, a lot of assistance, and all of those services are free for registered clients of the center. We also offer a series of seminars, some of which we charge for, some of which are free. Usually the ones that we charge for are the ones that give you things to take away. So please, collegeofdupage.edu, Center for Entrepreneurship, and you'll get in there to, is this my technical person? It's a login it's looking for, of some sort. So what we're here to do today is, we're here to talk about strategy and plans. Oh, you can't?
Not really.
Oh, I'm sorry. That's exciting to me because I am usually accused of being too loud. So, right.
Are you up on the screen at all? No. I don't even have anything on the screen.
Okay.
Just for the TV.
I know, but does it help you? Oh, so it's not.
Correct.
So you need me to shout?
Yes.
Okay. No problem. Okay. Yes.
Could you tell us your name again, please?
Sure. My name's Hilary Burkinshaw, B-U-R-K-I-N-S-H-A-W, one L in the Hilary and like Mrs. King. Correct? And my contact information is on the end of the PowerPoint slide, so you will see it, but I have business cards that I can give you. What I'm hoping to do today is to give you a few tips and tools that you can take away and use to implement in your business. So how many of you, you're all in business, right? Okay. How many of you are in service businesses? Almost 100%. How many of you are not in service businesses is a question I should ask. What sort of business are you?
Confectionery food productions.
Oh, okay.
I know.
Anybody else that's not? Okay. We have something.
We have it.
Not quite sure how to do this without pictures because I need you to do some of the tests and things like that. When we start to talk about leadership and strategic planning, the first thing that I want to talk about is you. Starting your own business starts with you. And you need to understand you to understand how you're going to develop this business and how you're going to make it work for you. So why did you get into business in the first place? Why did you get into business? Anybody willing to talk to me? Because I like to talk. Yes?
I didn't like how my, this is for design, just to be clear.
Okay.
So I didn't like how my employer was treating their clients. I thought
okay.
It was...
You thought you had a better way?
I thought I had a better way.
Better way? Okay. What about anybody else? Anybody else willing to share? Okay.
All right.
You could end up being my guinea pig all day long.
All right.
Okay. We have something. Store and go.
It isn't what I want.
Okay. So why you got into business is important. It's important to think about it. A lot of people will off the top of their head say, I got in for the money. But is that the real reason that you got into this business? Because really, businesses that are successful are exactly what you said. Businesses that solve a problem for somebody else.
Multiple display.
You need to find a better way of doing something. You need to have something that provides a solution that people need and that they're willing to pay for. So why you got into the business is kind of important because this is going to factor into the planning of the business. Where's this business going? A lot of times when clients walk into the center and they're talking to me and they're talking about the business and they're talking about what they want for the business, they're talking about the business, the now, the here, the now, I want a plan for this year, for next year. But nobody turns in and talks to you when they're starting a business about how they're going to get out of the business. What's the exit plan for the business? Where's the business going? Because if you think about it, it really is an important difference when it comes to understanding strategic plan one. Thank you. When it comes to understanding what sort of a business you're going to be planning. Thank you. I'm going to keep touching this now so that it works. So this is, it starts with you. We talked about why you got into the business, what sort of business you're in, where is the business going? Because if you want to IPO your business out in 5 years, that's a whole lot of difference in planning from somebody who wants a business that is going to sustain them through a lifestyle or somebody who wants a business that they're going to hand on to their sons, daughters, and future generations. It requires a different strategy and a different plan. And the other part of the where is the business going is when. When do you want to be out of this? Where and when is this business going? 5 years, 10 years, till you retire, till you never retire, My son-in-law's family still go into the business every single day, and they're in well into their 80s now. But they still go in every single day. No intentions of ever retiring. And this is my granddaughter, who would now is now 13 and would not forgive me for using this picture. But she started early, so I'm kind of proud of her.
She'd invented a drink. And then the other part of this is who? Who are you? Who are you as a business person? Who are you as a leader? What sort of things make you the sort of person who can run, own, operate this business? And there's a lot of stuff out there to help you figure this out. How many people are familiar with Myers-Briggs, DISC, all of these different sort of personality tests? And they tell you something about yourself, a little bit about your style and all of that sort of stuff. But I want to think back a little bit. I've been in America now for close on 30 years. And when I first came here, you know, there were small business development centers. I was able to teach on a course called small business management. There wasn't, it was part of a bigger course. It was part of business administration or business management or something like that. There wasn't very much on entrepreneurship per se. And over that 30 years, that's changed significantly. Now just about every college, university, every school has a course on entrepreneurship, a course specific. There are PhDs in entrepreneurship. There are whole divisions devoted to it. And yet, if you go back and look at the statistics about small business success or small business failure, whichever way you choose to look at it, they're not changed at all over the last 30 years. You know, they still spout 60 to 70, 78, whatever number they want to choose for the number of businesses that fail within the first 5 years and so on and so forth. So what's all that education been doing? Where is it all going? Is it any use? And one guy who's actually a local guy, Naperville guy, came up with this idea that part of the reason that nothing's changing is because business schools, entrepreneurship classes, put the same information out in front of the same people as if we are all automatons, as if we all behave in the same way. And he sort of started to look and said, there are some very specific entrepreneurial profiles, and you've developed this thing called bossy. Bossy, looking at what it is that you bring to the table. And bossydna.com is a place that you can go to and test yourself to find out what your bossy profile is. And it essentially is saying that, and I have guinea pigs in the audience here, people who have been there and done this test for me, and they're going to speak in a minute. But it actually says that entrepreneurs fall into one or two of these categories, and they usually give you two. A builder, an opportunist, specialist, or innovator. And I encourage you to do this, because it's kind of interesting. Builders are the people who like to build businesses. They like to put together the processes and everything that it takes to make it work. Not terribly good people persons, because they assume everybody's on their pathway to the top. Opportunists, they're sort of the salespeople. They see an opportunity, they grab it, and they move on to the next opportunity, even if the last one failed, and on they go from opportunity to opportunity. Specialists, they're your CPAs, your doctors, your dentists, people who have a specialism and build the businesses around that. And innovators, a lot of innovators fall into it quite by accident because they've created a product. Think your Zuckerbergs and your Steve Jobs. I've taken Steve's black on black, as it's a whole lot easier today. Who are really more interested in the product than in building a business. So, I asked two of my loyal followers here. I didn't know they were loyal followers till just now. Kathy and Sally both here. If you can take a couple of minutes just to explain to people what this is, I would appreciate it.
Come on, Kathy, I'm not doing this myself.
No.
Sally, and I met with Hilary last week, and she told me that she was going to bring up this profile. So I took it. It took I'm not even 10 minutes.
It's 10 questions.
Yeah, 10 mm-hmm. questions. Mm-hmm. So, and I took it twice because I didn't like the answers the first time. I got the same answer. So what it did, it told me that the my two DNA types were, the first one was opportunist. So I looked at that, and some of the things that it told me was my predisposed strengths are finding new money-making opportunities, promoting something I believe in, and being optimistic even after the toughest setback. And I think about when I closed my business 2 years ago, and good God, thank God I'm an optimistic person, right? Or I would probably still be wallowing in my bedroom. Promoting something I believe in. I do have pretty deep-seated beliefs and values, so it's very easy for me to promote that. So I thought that was pretty right on. And then finding new money-making opportunities, I do think I am good at seeing the money-making opportunities, and seeing new opportunities and hitting on those trends. So I liked that. Some of the weaknesses, maintaining a consistent long-term income. I think my husband might agree with that. Saying no to money-making opportunities. So seeing an opportunity and actually saying no to it. I actually think I'm pretty good at that, so I do disagree just a little bit with that. And then doing important administrative repetitive tasks. So that as a built-in weakness. I also don't agree with that because I am pretty good at setting up my systems and doing the things that I know I need to do to grow the business. The secondary DNA of specialist, I really did see that in myself as because I grew up as a computer programmer, I'm really good at that programming stuff. But what that told me there was I need to find people that play to those weaknesses. So the weaknesses of marketing, the weaknesses of branding. Some of those types of things that I'm not great at. And then I wanted to ask Hilary, I did have an asterisk next to specialist.
Mm-hmm.
It appears that I have more than one secondary DNA.
Yes.
So
okay.
I need to take an advanced test to get that
yes.
secondary DNA?
Okay. You do.
Perfect.
Yeah. I mean, truly everybody has a little bit of all four of them, but sometimes they're closer than others. So thank you. Kathy, do you
sure.
want to?
So, yes, 10 questions, very quick, easy to take. Interesting, I looked at it in one way, and I was taken aback, and I thought, oh my gosh, maybe I'm in the wrong business after 33 years, but I think I've got that figured out here. I am an innovator and a specialist.
Okay, same as me.
Yeah, so the innovator part of it, my strengths are being creative and designing breakthrough products, which is interesting. In my business, I have to fit within a framework, but I think that I find ways to bring ideas, and if it's not within my business, sometimes I think what's interesting is I digress a little bit. It's not only what you do in your business, but it's also what you do in your community and how you can be useful and strengthen and bring things to the table inside your community. And so that was very helpful with me. So being creative, trying to design a breakthrough product, having a virtually limitless R&D pipeline was a strength. And I look at that word as collaboration. I'm a good collaborator, and I feel that that's a strong strength for myself. And the last one is a desire to change the world. Well, if not the world, maybe LaGrange, maybe the LGBT, maybe something. I think that all fits very well with who I am. My weaknesses are problem solving and business strategy, and I think the executive board would probably agree with that. I like to look to people to say, you know, how do we implement this? I'm good at understanding the problem, but how do we make the change in this happening? Engaging in conflict, firing employees, savvy negotiating. Oh, I hate that. Oh, gosh, that's the worst thing in the world. And so that's where I look to people like Sally and Sally's coaching business and business strategy and things like that. So you find your resources. And the last built-in weakness, this always makes me cringe and says salesmanship. And how have I been in a sales business for 33 years and been able to do what I wanted to do? But I think it's because I don't walk in and say, hey, you need to buy this. I don't sell. I try and do a collaboration, and it's a referral, and it's just a relationship business, and I think that's where I'm comfortable. So maybe true salesmanship is not me, but maybe I sell in a different way. Mm-hmm. And so I thought it was amazing.
Okay.
So thank you both.
All right. I put this back up so that for those of you that didn't get a chance to get these links, I will, if anybody wants this presentation, I'd be happy to email it to you. After the event, just drop me your business card and I will email it for you. I also gave you Joe Abrams is the guy who created Bossy DNA, and he did a few TED Talks. You can find them just by going to YouTube, the TED Talks. So he does the talks a lot more interestingly than I do, but he does also say that he has used this with companies, because not only is it telling you about your skills, but it tells you where you're lacking, where you have gaps. So when you're looking at building resources, whether that's subcontractors, whether that's creating employees, whatever it is, it does give you some idea of where you might want to go for other skills. We had a young man on our last accelerator program, came in from Brazil, did this, and went, oh, this is brilliant, in a Portuguese accent, and went over to his company, had everybody on his management team do their Bossy DNA, and then turned around and said, if the next guy that we hire doesn't have opportunity skills, we don't want him. Because they looked at the profile of his management team, and there were no real opportunists on that team. And he said, you know, they're trying to expand into America. He said, we need salespeople. We need people to come out and do this. So not only was it useful to him to know what his strengths and weaknesses were, but also when it came to putting that team together and building that team. So, but now I kind of want to talk to you a little bit about strategy. As I say, the first step to my mind is to thine own self be true. Know yourself, know who you are, where you're going, what it is you're doing for everybody else, and when you want to get to wherever you're going. Okay. See the first quote that I ever had on this, I don't know if you saw it, but it's a quote from Winston Churchill, which for people in America I could translate into Eisenhower because it's attributed to all of them in slightly different terminology over the years. Most times you come up against strategy and people talking about strategy, they're talking about war. So I went and looked for a couple of definitions just so that I can start to see if we can get some hang on to what is this thing about strategy. And a method or a plan chosen to bring about a desired end. Again, I go back to what I said earlier. If you don't know where the end point is, it's going to be hard to get there. So it's a plan of action. Action being the important word here. It's not a plan that is going to go to the banker, and hope that they will lend you money. This is a plan. A strategy creates a plan to run your business, to get your business from here to the end point. And then this one, as you can tell, came from some war thing. But it is the art of combining and employing the means of war in planning and directing large military operations. I picked these because I think that there are some important words in this. I think words are important. Method and plan, bringing about desired future. Plan of action for a long-term overall aim. And art of combining and employing. I think these are important things to remember when you're developing some sort of strategy. Again, clients come into my office and you need a plan, you need an action, and they go, do you have an outline? Well, yes, I have an outline. And I can give you the outline, and you can fill in all the blanks in the outline. It's not going to give you a strategy, it's not going to give you a plan. Well, it's going to give you something, a piece of paper, with a lot of writing on it. But that's not what you're looking for here. Because to my mind, a strategy is not a plan. It is more than a plan. A strategy is framework. It's the skeleton on which you hang your plan on. Because it's the framework you use to make business decisions. Not a plan. It does not tell you how to implement it. That's what planning is about. Implementation is about planning.
Strategy is direction. But the one thing a strategy does do is it tells you what business you are not in and what you do not need to do. It clarifies all of the things that are unimportant. As small business owners, you are faced all the time by people wanting to sell you things, people coming to you, offering you things. Do you use Facebook? Do you use Instagram? Should you use social media at all? Are you going to use tradition? You've got a whole slew of decisions that you've got to make. You need a way of digging through that maze and getting down so that you can make decisions easily and quickly. And that's what a strategy tries to give you. It tries to eliminate what you do and clarify, eliminate what you don't need and clarify what you do need. Does that make sense? I'm not used to talking permanently with nobody talking back to me, and I will talk. So please feel free to talk back to me anytime you want. Because a lot of this is something that, I've been doing this working with small businesses for 30 years, and a lot of this is built on what I've seen over the years. And, I'll be really honest with you, the people who write a plan because they've got the bank said so, or because their best friend said so, are not the people who succeed. When my brother went to be self-employed, and I said, Tim, you need a plan, he went, oh, darling, one is in the media, one does not do these things, you know. Of course, that's my brother. But he sent me seven lines, and those seven lines identified that strategy. It was a framework. This is what my business is going to do. This is how much money I'm willing to put in. These are the benchmarks that if I achieve at a certain time will trigger different actions. These are people I want to employ. This is how I want to, whether I'm owning equipment or not. This is where I want to work from, but just a framework. So the successful plans can be a framework, but it needs to describe all of these things. I'm completely leaving my notes behind here. You're in dangerous territory now. So, who drives your business success? What drives your business success? What drives your business success?
Happy customers.
Happy customers.
Your actions.
Your actions.
Staff. Results.
Results. Think,
A sense of accomplishment.
Sense of accomplishment?
A sense of purpose.
Purpose. Have all of these got into your planning for your business? Have you done it? And who do you think are the main stakeholders in your business? We've already said customers, somebody said employees. Who are the main stakeholders in your business, do you think?
Well, customers, consumers, we got that. What about these suppliers? Well, a lot of you are service businesses, so it's probably not terribly important to you, but if State Farm don't supply you with good policies, you've got a bit of a problem there. Employees, we mentioned. You. We talked about you. You're an important stakeholder in your business, are you not? You're not going to stay in this business if you're not making money, are you? Although I did read a very alarming report that came out of QuickBooks last week that said that they estimate that now small businesses lose on average $43,000 a year because of inadequate cash flow. And that's in terms of contracts that they do not take because of that poor cash flow. But that's a whole other issue. You as owners are an important stakeholder in this business. I venture to suggest that the community that you operate in is probably an important stakeholder in it. And for some people, the environment. How many people have any sort of environmental consciousness going on in their businesses?
Yeah.
Yes?
Yeah.
More and more. If you're not, for environment, read social conscience. More and more people are looking, or consumers are looking, for some sort of sustainability, social conscience, even if it's just a recycled mark on the paper that you use. How many times, when you've done your planning, have you actually thought in terms of these stakeholders in your business? Because, you see, understanding the stakeholders is one part, but what you've got to understand is, what do these people want from you? What do these people want from you? And what do you want from them? What do you want from your customers?
Okay. To buy,
hmm?
To purchase,
oh,
to make a transaction.
You want their money. I mean, seriously, you want their money. You want their loyalty because you want their money over and over and over again.
Their satisfaction.
Because you want their money over and over and over again. Yes. What about your employees? What do you want from them?
Loyalty.
Loyalty.
Dependability.
Dependability?
Creativity.
Yeah. Why? Because you want them to be productive. Because you want them to generate money.
Well, client experience.
Hmm?
Client experience is everything. So if you have a creative, happy employee, more than the money, if you have a...
Absolutely.
Remember the experience.
So Richard Branson has always said, keep happy employees and the money follows. Always said that. Your suppliers, what do you want from them?
Quality partnership, loyalty to your brand.
Yeah, good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Good stuff for you to pass on. I mean, it's interesting, for those of us that care, there's a little exercise going on in the UK right now called Brexit. And one of the side effects of Brexit is that Nissan and Honda have both said that they will leave the UK post-Brexit. And why? Because of their supply chain. Because their supply chain requires just-in-time inventory. And with the new customs documentation that will happen and all of that, they can no longer guarantee just-in-time inventory. And that is so crucial to their strategy that they're moving. It's cheaper to move the whole business, 10,000 jobs, out of the country than to worry about supply chain. All of these things are crucial for your plan. Whoops. Because what you want is going to translate into your objectives. A lot of times people will come in and they'll go, I want improved sales, I want more money, greater profits, all of that sort of stuff. Well, that's great. They're your goals. We'll come to those in a while. But you don't get those without considering all of these other factors. So it's worth understanding what you want from those stakeholders. If you want somebody, if you are the Porsche of your industry and you want somebody who will buy a new car once every 5 years and spend a fortune on it, you've got one set of policies and one set of strategies. On the other hand, if you're the Honda and people will buy it a lot more frequently, then different strategy for your business. So who your customers are, what they want, crucial. Product and all of the rest of it. Does this make sense? The other side of that, as I mentioned before, is taking an outside view.
What do they want from you? What do they want from you? We've already talked about the best products are the products that solve problems. So the first answer probably is they want solutions to their problems. Have you ever bothered to think about what problems you're solving for people? How does that fit into your strategy? Well, I have a cleaner that comes every couple of weeks and she drives me crazy if I'm ever in the house, which I was this morning, unfortunately. But I am willing to pay for that inconvenience because I want to not be. It solves a problem for me. It used to be that I didn't have time, now it's just convenience. It doesn't matter who those stakeholders are, you as owners, and that might be shareholders or joint owners, they want to keep making money. Your suppliers want to make money. They want a regular supply of orders. They want you to regularly fulfill those orders so that their income stream is satisfied. Your employees, a little more difficult now, because people turn around and say, they want money. Well, yes, I'm sure they do. But is that the only thing that they're looking for? You know, pat on the back maybe would be nice sometimes. Yay, good job. Here's a corner bakery lunch for you, thank you very much. You know, these are part of your strategy. Not things that are going to go into the business plan and you're going to take to the bank. I'm sorry to keep calling you on the bank. It's nice to be out of the home business, so I can't do it myself. When you're thinking about strategy, you're thinking big picture. You're thinking, who am I, what is my business, where is it going to go, and how fast is it going to get there? You are thinking, who are the main stakeholders in my business? What do I want out of them? How do I turn that into my objectives? And what do they want out of me? And how does that figure in to how I design my product, how I design my business, how I present myself to the outside world? And then, you're probably ready to look at what goals are. So I want to have a little look, just if I've not belabored the point enough for you, but I hope I haven't. Difference between strategy and goals. Strategy, how your resources should be allocated to accomplish the mission. Again, you've got all of that war talk. You can hear it coming into these things. Strategy is an exercise in problem solving. And goals are there to support it. They are not going to solve the problems. They're there to measure your progress towards solving said problems. And yet, all too often when people are developing strategic plans, business plans, or whatever it happens to be, you see a list of goals. Fairly short term often, 6 to 12 month goals. And if you get focused on the 6 to 12 month goals and lose the big picture in all of this, then you're constantly going to be running for some short term success. Or you're going to be measuring yourself as a failure against a goal that was just a 6 month goal anyway, and should have been something that you pivoted from after 6 months. What are you with me so far?
Mm-hmm. I'm always conscious of the fact that when I talk like this, you know, people get bored. So that's why I get worried when you're not talking back to me.
Already.
So just to try and simplify stuff, I thought we'd try and give you an example of what a strategy is. So
company has got something, they devise something to solve entrepreneurial burnout, and they're not making it as yet, surprisingly. Works well in LaGrange, does great, but they need to get it out to a wider community. They need to get it out to DuPage, to Illinois, to the Midwest, to the US, to the world. Lots of options. Lots of different ways you can do that. You can go and be an Anthony Robbins and do the rolling road tour and collect money as you go along. You can license it, train the trainer, get a slew of trainers out there, go online, put it all online, hope that people buy, and so on and so forth. These are strategies. They're not telling you how to do it. They're just looking at the options. So if you're looking at your business, you're probably going to come up with a ton of strategies about how you can proceed. Then you're going to have to choose the ones that work best, the one or the ones that work best for you. Then you're going to have to plan the implementation. Big picture, going down.
A bird.
As we walk along this maze of business planning, and it is a maze, there are millions of books out there that are there. There are millions of outlines. You can buy a business plan online. You can pull one off without buying it. Any type of business under the sun. It's not your plan, not your business, but if that's the way you choose to do it, go for it. But one of the things that people get confused about all the time is, where does this vision mission thing fit in? What's vision and mission? So once you've got your strategy, your vision is kind of that strategy. Your vision is the long term. Where are you going to? Where do you want to be? What's that end point? And here's the one, and sorry, I'm out of closure ears now. Coming out of educational institutions for the longest time and seeing mission statements that are plastered around the walls of the institution that are too long for anybody to read or care about. I have a problem with mission statements, but here we go. That's why mission goes into the bit that you can't read very well. A mission really talks about what business the organization is in and what it is not, now and in the future. It's there. The mission is there for focus for the management team, or for management, to send down to everybody who works for them. So the vision is the big picture. The mission is really the focus, the here and now. This is what we're going to do. This is where we're going to go. I like to think about it in terms of Google. Makes life easier for me. Google's vision was to provide, to make information accessible to everybody. That's their mission, their vision. Their mission then was to gather together a behemoth of a database, make it searchable, make it accessible, make it easy for people to utilize. So the vision, make it all available for everybody. The mission is how to put that into practice and into action. How about for your business? Anybody ever articulated the visions and the missions?
Tried many times.
Uh-huh.
It's very difficult to put a mission statement that's all encompassing and have everybody buy into it to make it go forward.
Thank you. This is super easy for me to stand here and talk about. Super easy. It is not that easy to do. What tends to happen with that vision, that that mission statement is exactly what Kathy was saying. We want to try and say everything. And then we cannot resist all the adjectives like first class, superlative, high level services too. It's very difficult. Think about it. Anybody want to have a go at telling me what their mission is for their business? I don't blame you. I'm honestly, I don't. It is very difficult. And that's why you end up with those things that are plastered all around walls, is because they're really trying to be all things to all people. In certain instances, they have to be. And it's very difficult to get that into a few words. What do you think the value is of a mission statement and a vision statement?
I think they should keep you focused. It's very easy, especially like in the case of Google. How does Google monetize?
Mm-hmm.
They sell ads.
Mm-hmm.
That's how they make their money.
Mm-hmm.
How else do they make their money? You know, it's really their purpose, their vision has nothing to do with making money.
Right.
And their mission really has nothing to do with making money. But they're in business and they've made a ton of money.
Mm-hmm.
So it's for small businesses, I think it's very difficult. Like I have a vision for my business.
Mm-hmm.
But in order for my business to prosper, I have to like not stay on task.
Okay. Wow.
Well,
I'm curious. If you can say it in a few words and you don't mind sharing, that's fine. Let me go back. When you say not stay on task, does that mean that you change direction frequently?
No.
Okay.
The vision has remained the same for the 8 years I've been in business.
Okay.
But in accomplishing that vision,
mm-hmm.
there have been a lot of other things that I've done.
Okay.
That are not, don't take me directly to the vision.
Okay. So they don't take you away from it, do they?
I don't know, but I think maybe they do.
Oh.
Because there's just, I think as a small business, there's so many things you have to do, and there's so many things you want to do to keep your business going,
mm-hmm.
keep it prospering.
Right.
So that you don't necessarily only do the things that are within your mission.
Okay.
Okay.
I think that what you're saying there actually encompasses part of this problem of pulling together a mission statement. Because when you're doing a mission statement, you are trying to capture all of those things that you need to do. But then life happens. Different things come up. Maybe you didn't think of the community as part of your vision, but suddenly you become very involved in a community organization as part of your business. And so, that's not necessarily in your mission, but it's out there. I think this is where people have problems, and where I have problems with developing mission statements for people. What I find a little simpler is to look at what your values are and to identify the values that guide your business. If you go and look at Starbucks on their website, their mission statement actually says more about their values, I think, than their mission. And so a lot of people find it a lot easier to look at their values that describes the culture of the organization that they want, that tells the outside world, these are the things that are important to us. And then they can use that as a way of guiding the business forward. So if you don't have problems, my advice to anybody is do not belabor the whole mission, vision, and values. Vision, I think, is important. Vision can be very personal and very purposely held to yourself. Mission is difficult to put together, difficult to describe, and should be changing and evolving. But your values are something that stay consistent. And that doesn't matter for you as a person, they change slightly over time. We have a guy who comes into our accelerator program, and he is a several bazillionaire type person, but he says that to this day,
He still has 10 values that he holds to be true that have changed slightly over the years, and he keeps them on his bedroom mirror at all times, even when they change. And, you know, he said that even through businesses and everything else, holding to those values as being that guiding light that a mission statement may or may not be. So, and every time I've listened to him speak, I go home and I, right, values. On the fridge. And they're still not there. I try. Mission, vision, and values. Do not get yourself tied up in the loop of worrying about these things if they are not things, you know, if they're going to distract you. The other thing that working with entrepreneurs for 30 years has shown me is that paralysis by analysis is incredibly easy when I start to give these sort of guidelines and these sort of talks. A lot of people can go away and just bury themselves in that minutiae because it's easier than looking at the problems, especially businesses with issues. I worry when I find a business owner who is working in their business so diligently and can't get out of it because it's so important that they're there to get it done, because now I start to look for bigger problems. You know, I want you to start thinking about working in your business and thinking about working on, and again, it's another one of those phrases that you've probably heard way too often and you get fed up of hearing, but hopefully we can try and implement a bit of it moving forward. I like to use my family in this. The bird was not my family, but that's my nephew. Playing for Otley. Otley. Okay, goals. A lot of goals. Finally, these are the building blocks, the bottom level to some degree of the plan. These are your benchmarks for your strategy. These are the way you judge yourself. Tim's, if I've not earned X amount in 6 months and I'm going to look for a real job, was one of his benchmarks. They need to be smart. We've all come across SMART goals, right? Good, because I can never remember what all the SMART stands for sometimes. Especially when I'm standing in front of a TV camera. Your goals need to be SMART. Importantly, they need to be measurable and timely. If nothing else, measurable. I want to lose 20 pounds this year is great. It's measurable. And this year gives me a time frame in which I've got to do it. Of course, it's also instantly forgettable. Because it's not going onto the door of the fridge. One of those values. And they need to be regularly reviewed. Goals are building blocks. They are not set in stone. These are things that need to be regularly reviewed. First of all, because hopefully you've achieved them. And you need to move on to the next step. Or you've not achieved them and you're not going to achieve them and you need to know when to pivot. The biggest problem people have is chasing a goal when it's impossible. Because they have no benchmarks, no measurable things halfway or timely in that goal that says, this is when I really need to think about this and figure out whether it's working or not, whether I need to change. You need to review your goals regularly, and it's okay. It's absolutely okay to say this isn't working. But it's why you need to measure everything. Opening that Facebook page is great, but if nobody's coming to your Facebook page, then there's a time to stop banging on your Facebook page and look for something else that will work. You can tell how old I am. Still go to Facebook as an example. My grandkids are so embarrassed by me. It's terrible. So goals, they're there, they're benchmarks, need to be smart and regularly reviewed. We're almost there, you'll be happy to know. We're almost at the end. Well, this is one of my little bet noirs, if you will. Plans versus planning. I go right back to the quote right at the beginning. When it comes to battle, plans are useless, but planning is everything. Too many times I see people produce a plan. The plan. A plan is there for an external audience. It's there for you and me and the bankers, right? I want to know what you've got in there. It doesn't help you too much when it comes to running your business, to be honest, unless it's a plan that you've written specifically for that purpose. Planning. Plans done without planning, without research, without background, without information. Plans based on insufficient information are not going to work. There's a whole thing, an article I read not long ago about what they call thin slicing. And that is about management who are making decisions on too little information. They're thin slicing that information and making decisions. And then with no benchmarks on it, they're chasing things that they really don't know about. We have a resource center at COD as part of the things that we do in the Center for Entrepreneurship. And that gives you access to so much information that you can get paralysis by analysis quite easily, but you can also get the information that you need. How many businesses are there that meet your criteria in DuPage County? Easy enough to find out if you just know where to look and how to look. How many households fit your criteria? So on and so on, whatever it happens to be, whatever you need, you can generally get that information. It is where reference librarians become your friend. Because reference librarians love telling you where to go for information, how to get it, and where to find it, and how to find it. They are wonderful people. They're your friend. I didn't even know I was going to do a plug for the library as part of this. Planning built on knowing where you are now. Know yourself. Know where you are now. Understand that business is fluid and unpredictable. So monitor and be prepared to pivot. It's guidance rather than control. And write it down. Between leaving here and getting to my house, I will have had 20 ideas of how I can change this presentation and make it better or different. And when I get home, I'll be so relieved. I'll do what we Brits always do, look at the weather and make a cup of tea. I'll forget to write it down, and then next time I have to do one, I'll go, what was that idea? Write it down. If you want a plan that works, write it down. It's not a master's thesis. It can be 7 sentences. You're not giving it for a grade, so it can be wrong. You are not going to offend anybody by it or upset anybody by it. So you can put into it whatever you need to put into it. You only need to amend it when it comes time for publication, if it ever does. But it's your plan. It is a work in progress. It is never done. It is never finished. It is never complete and not needing changes. It is always a work in progress. For those of you that are familiar with your financial statements, you can give me a balance sheet for the 31st of December 2018, and I will take it and do your financial analysis based on it, knowing that on the 1st of January 2019, everything had changed. You got to get used to assuming and making assumptions, because part of the value of writing it down is that you can start to test out the assumptions that you make. So be aware of what assumptions you're making when you're writing this plan out, so that you can test them. You can share it with a counselor in the center. You can use a counselor in the center to keep you accountable. You can share it with somebody in the center, because you are your business. You are so intimately involved with this business, you don't see it all. A lot of times when people bring business plans, I read them through and I'm like, and I call them and I ask them, they'll go, oh, but blah, 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 blah. And it's like, well, of course. It's so obvious to them, they don't bother putting it in the plan. because it's not obvious to me as a reader, I see things that you don't see. So use the plan. Make it a living document. Make it easy for yourself. Do not be tied to it. So, pulling it all together, know yourself. To thine own self, be true. Know your leadership style, DNA if you want it. Know your personal goals. I didn't really say too much about that, but it is one thing that I think is important. It's very difficult in a small business environment to separate personal and business goals. Your personal goals are inextricably linked with your business goals. So know what you want out of the business. Know what, I haven't earned X amount by this time, by in 6 months, I'm going to look for a different job, or if I haven't made X number of sales, I've earned enough money, I'm going to change, do some different tasks, make a difference, make a change. Know your current business situation. You'll all have come across SWOTs, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. Again, do a thumbnail sketch of it, go in depth, wherever you want to be, but know your environment. Know the environment that your business is operating in. Know what trends, know what things are happening. You can speak to, it's kind of ironic that I'm going on now for Brexit, because we lost a business because of joining the European Common Market when my father did. Because of not taking enough note of the changes that were going to happen when we joined the European market. So I'm hoping that there are not a lot of businesses over there now struggling without knowing what's going to happen when they leave. Although I know they are, because they don't know whether we're leaving or not. Understand your business situation, understand the business environment, not just your business, but the environment, the greater environment you operate in. Know who your key stakeholders are, and what your expectations are from them, and what their expectations are from you. Mission, vision, and values, as you want them or as you need them, but certainly vision, and I would suggest values. Goals, think planning versus a plan. Revisit it regularly. That, I think, ladies and gentlemen, is it from me. Oh, no, I've got to lead you into the next one. So, I'm going to lead you into the next one. We wanted to leave you with something to do. And from everything that I've said, you probably think that writing this sort of plan is some nasty and onerous task. So I tried to pull it down into a one-pager. Try and get you to take that sort of strategic overview, if you will, of your plan. To identify what your purpose is, vision, purpose, whatever it happens to be. To look at what your focus is going to be for this year. Or if you don't want this year's focus, next 6 months, choose your time frame. This is your plan. What are your key objectives or your key areas that you're going to be chasing in terms of the market? And when I talk about the market, I'm talking about customers, product, pricing, any of those things that are important to the consumer. Are you going to need to look at any process improvements? That's not going to be applicable to everybody. If it's not applicable, don't use the box. Are you going to need to do anything in terms of people, staffing, product development, financial development? What are your key performance indicators going to be? Goals. What are you looking for? How are you going to measure yourself in all of those areas? And how much money are you going to commit to each of them? Simple, straightforward overview. Again, if you want to send me an email,
I will send you this electronically so that you're not filling in these crazy little boxes. And what we're going to do as we come back next time is try and get some feedback from you guys, the bits that you're willing to share about how this process has gone for you. You don't have to share too much of the plan if you don't want to, but how the process has gone, and then look at some detail that go into different plans. Does that sound like a plan? Good. Because I thought I would leave you with the last time Britain did the great big split, Hadrian's Wall. This actually is the Roman toilets. They were a little bit ahead of us. Central heating and not quite flushing toilets. And I believe there were walls around so that they weren't looking out into Scotland, but there we go. And as you can see, Mr. Hadrian's plan did not go too well. His wall has fallen. And this is the reason why plans go awry. So I want you to be aware of that. Dysfunctional team. If you are a solo entrepreneur, for dysfunctional team, read, not quite sure what I'm doing and why I'm doing it. For dysfunctional team. Not sure what my why is. Staff not aligned to your core values. Poorly defined customers. Core customers, define them. Drama, too much drama. And the big one, failure to master cash flow. Cash is king. I don't care how profitable you are. Profitable businesses fail every day because they do not have cash. We will be talking about cash flow, just to give you a warning. My information. My email address, the 630 phone number is great, except that I've forgotten my code to open the voicemail, so it's probably better to use the 708 number. I do have my card for you. As I say, we are the Center for Entrepreneurship. We have the three centers. Call me, go onto the website, and you will get access to all of the centers. Thank you very much for your time.
Hilary, very much for kind of reminding us from some of the things that we might have learned in business school but maybe have forgotten. And I think that it's so important to be able to visit it each year and tweak it and see how it's working, what is it working, and maybe your values are a little bit different than when you started. I know I can look back from beginning to 33 years later and it's the same, but it's very different. And I know as small business owners, there are so many struggles and things you're bombarded with on a day, but sometimes staying true to your vision and the reason why you're there is going to continue to make you the leader and successful in your business. So hopefully you gained something useful from this first session. When we come back in April, maybe a box or two is filled in. Maybe something that will help you clarify some of the thinking on your own business and take you to the next level, or help you help somebody else become a leader. So thanks very much. We appreciate it, and we'll see you next month.
And can I remind you for the evaluation forms and the registration forms, please?
Yes, please. That would help the College of DuPage, and it helps keep our partnership strong with them. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.